I changed the title of the slides from Test Your Microservices with Rest Assured to Buzzword Services because I saw a presentation by Marcus yesterday, and I'm not allowed to use the word microservice anymore because according to him it doesn't mean anything, so I replaced this. Who am I? I'm Michel Schudel. I work at a small software company in the Netherlands called Craftsman. We do all kinds of cool stuff like flying with drones, doing IoT stuff, and then we suddenly realized there's also some money to be made, so we also work at Dutch Railways, IRS, and a plethora of other clients. So I'm going to talk to you about testing. Exciting, isn't it? Everybody likes, I always throw a picture of a kitten in between, just I love cats. So, contents I want to talk to you about today are a little bit of context about REST testing, and then I'm going to introduce you to REST Assured. Maybe you've seen the Spock presentation already, so it's a little bit similar to that. I'm going to give a demo, and then I'm going to show you how this integrates with Spring Boot and traditional Spring applications. I do a wrap-up, and if there's any time left, I'll do some Q&A and be done with that. So, who here is developing micro buzzword services? A few of you, yeah, like 15, okay. Who's working with REST interfaces on a daily basis? Okay, quite a lot of you, great. And who of you use automated testing to test these interfaces? Quite a few of you also, okay, great. So I'm gonna ask you about how you are going to do this in a moment, but to get everybody on the same page, I would like to tell you a little bit what I understand about REST testing. So I'm going to talk today about component testing. So a component test against the REST boundary of your service. So this means you have a conference service running somewhere. So I saw this example quite a few times today. And you have some kind of testing framework that tests against this conference service, like through a get or a post or a delete or something like this. The service will give a response, and then of course you can assert all kinds of these things on this response, like checking the name or description, begin end date, and the city. So this is of course the only conference that matters. There are a few types of tests. I'm mainly going to talk about out-of-process testing today. So this means your service is already deployed on a network somewhere. This could be a local host as well. And the test framework makes a real network call to this service, and the service maybe accesses some external resource like a GMS provider or an external database, or maybe, you know, if you're really volatile with your data, an in-memory database, and assert from there. What you can also do, and you see this a lot of in Spring IT testing, is you do everything in process. So this means you spin up just one JVM, and then you do like an in-memory call, but for those of you who are used to Spring IT testing, it's like kind of invisible with this mock MVC structure. But everything is in one JVM, and so if the JVM is finished, everything is thrown away again. So I'm going to show you a little bit of this as well. And then there's another category, it's called contract testing. It's basically also an out-of-process test, but you test against someone else's API to see if their API still fulfills the requirements that your service expects. And, well, you have different frameworks for that, like Pact and Spring Cloud Contract. So I'm mainly going to talk about these two. Yeah? So who tests their REST APIs by hand? I expect no hands. Well, maybe one who's doubting. Okay. Anybody using SOAP UI? Yeah, quite a few of you. We did this as well. And Postman, anyone? That's pretty cool. Yeah. Right. So we tried on our project all these different kinds of tools, and also we said, well, it's not really readable for the business. The question is, should it be readable for the business? I don't know. But we also did this. So we started with Cucumber, and we basically said, you know, a conference and a service should return a conference, and then given when then, and the attribute name should be the conference name, right? So this is human readable. The problem is, you have to write a lot of glue code for this to work. So maybe this looks something like this. You have like a when, and then you put some request parameters in your request. You call the actual service, and then in the then statement, you say, okay, now let's assert something that the status code that I expect from this service is actually the status code that it should be. And maybe then I want to drill down in the response itself and say, you know, let's get the JSON response from this and see if it the contents of this JSON response are what I expect. So yeah, for one call, this works pretty well, but it's not really readable anymore. And the BDD-like style test kind of is being obfuscated by all this Java code, you know? So we tried this a while and it worked pretty well, but we still had to write a lot of glue code. So that's what Johan Halleby also thought. So he started Rest Assured in 2010 already, so it's quite a few years old. And this basically allows you to test in a JUnit fashion. It has 100% Java DSL API, but it's implemented in Groovy. So you can use a lot of GPath and Groovy syntax stuff to assert stuff, which you will see in a demo in a few moments. And it really focuses on BD-like testing. So everything in the API circles around given, when, then. And this really helped us to reduce a lot of boilerplate code we had. So we threw all Qcremer tests away, incrementally, of course, and replaced everything by Rest Assured testing, step by step. So if you want to use Rest Assured, how do you have to start it? Well, it's easy, just include a Maven library. Or if you use Gradle, you use the line on the bottom, which is even shorter, so it's really easy. There are a few dependencies that you may have to include yourself, like JSON paths or XML paths if you want to use that, but for simplicity, this is all you need if you're going to do basic REST testing, yeah? So, what does a REST test look like? So you write a basic unit test, and it has three parts, given, when, then. So given, you set up the request in, so you can put all kinds of stuff in there, like content type, headers, parameters, cookies, and whatnot. And then you go to the when part, and that's actually the part where you do your get or post or delete. And after the then part, you assert a bunch of stuff. So this can be anything you want to check in the response. So that's basically all Rest Assured does. But of course, I'm going to give a demo now, so I hope it fares better for me than this guy. If you look up Phil Demo, the first picture you see on Google is this guy, so Steve Ballmer, if you don't know. So, let me check for a moment. The cable is a little bit, yeah. Can you still hear me? Yeah? Good. So, now I'm going to go to the demo. So, let's see. So, basically what I've done, I've created a conference service. So, that's, I think, the sixth variant I saw today. And let's see if I can make this a little bit smaller. Yeah, so it's basically a simple CRUD service, right? So, you can get conferences with this thing. You can post conferences. You can delete stuff. And you can also do it through... Oh, I'm sorry. let's see. Mirror. Is it there? Good. Yeah, sorry about that. So this is basically, I have a Swagger interface on top of this REST service. And you can do gets, posts, deletes, and maybe through a path parameter you can get stuff. So it's really simple CRUD operation, right? So it's easy. And there's also, if you don't specify a parameter, you will get all the conferences. You will get something like this, right? So to give you an idea of how this service works. So if we want to write a test, it's really easy. So we start with given. And this is the only problem of Rest Assured, to find a good code format. I haven't found one yet, so I have to do this by hand. So given when, get, so and now I want to have the conference URL. So that's that. And then, let's see, what should we test? Well, let's start with just the status code, okay? So like this. And of course, if you want to format this nicely, it would look something like this, right? Yeah? So this is really easy, given, when, then. So let's run this. And you will see that it fails, and this was to be expected, because if you look at what actually happens, is there's a connection refused because my server is not running yet. So this It's a little bit, yeah, you know, but I want to show a failing test before I show a succeeding test. So I'm now going to start the app. So it was like conference application. So this is Spring Boot app. So you've seen a few of those already, I think. So I'm going to start this. So there was nice GBCN conf ASCII art, which went away really quickly. So now it's running. And now I can go back to the test. And now it's running, right? Okay, so that's a real simple example of rest assured structure. You could even shorten this like this. And this will also run. So you don't, if you don't have any parameters or cookies or headers to set up, you can just skip that part and do it like this. But for simplicity's sake, I will put it back now. So now I have a status code, so that's very nice. And now I want to maybe, you know, validate something. So let's say I want to test something in the body, and I want to test, you know, that the name. And these are hamcrest matchers actually, so you can use all hamcrest matchers available. Equal to. I think I already had a constant for that. Yeah, I did. So, like this, right? So, if I'm going to run this, I will make this a little bit larger. So now it fails because it says name doesn't match, and you see I expected this name, but actually it says it's an array of conference names. So this is because the I actually call this endpoint, so it gives me a list of conferences. So how can I verify that the name actually is correct? So I can do this by using name like this. So this is the first name in the list of conferences. And then it works, right? So, of course, this is not really nice, and maybe, you know, I want to have some more information about what actually happens when I send this request. So what you can also do is add some logging. So I can say, give me log, and I want to have, like, everything. And for the response, I want the same. So you have to specify this for the request and the response. Oh, and as you can see here in the API, you can also choose the logged response only when the validation fails. So this is handy because when your test succeeds, you don't want to know anything any more information. So this is useful. Now I'm going to set it to all right now, because otherwise you won't see anything. So run this. And now you see that rest assured actually logs the request and also response. So if something goes wrong, this is a real easy way to debug a little bit of stuff and see what actually comes back. So of course I'm searching for a name here, and I expect it to be the first element, so that's not very nice, right? So I want to know if this conference here in Barcelona is actually contained within the list of conferences. So what I can now do is use, I think I made a shortcut for this. I can use a Groovy closure within this Java API. So this basically says, you know, find me all the conferences where the name starts with J and give me the name attribute of that. So now I can, the output of this will be a simple string, and I can assert this to the normal equals. There's a slight problem. Let's see. Expected actual find all. Oh, of course, yeah. This still gives me a list of names. So I have to say, like, a good hamcrest matcher for this is has items, I think. So this works, right? So this is a really powerful way to dig into your response tree and get all kinds of stuff from the response. So if you want to see more of this, you can look into the rest assured documentation, because I don't have the time to demonstrate all the Groovy closures you can do. So this is still a list of all conferences, right? So now I want to like do something more with Given. So I can say, oh. And now I really need Given because now I'm gonna specify a parameter. So Given, for example, parameter ID, I wanna search one specific conference. Don't touch a caps lock. When gets, so this is all the same. Then body name, and now it's of course just a name because I have only one object, equal to GBCN conf 2017. So what happens now is the request parameter ID is concatenated to the get URL, right? So it's like question mark ID is one. So this works. So what actually happens here is I specify param, but I didn't specify what kind of param. So no query param or for param or something like this. So rest assured, looks at if I do a get or a post or a delete, and decide from there which parameter it's going to send. So in this case, it will send a query parameter. You can also force this by use query param or, for example, form param. But I won't do that in a get, but you can force it. But normally I use just this, so it's much easier. I can also specify a pass parameter. Same way. And then, of course, the conference URL will change to like this, right? Conference and ID. So this still works, I hope. Yeah, it still works. And you could have also done it like this. So you specify it here, you throw it away here, and now it's inline. So this still works. Yeah. So this is about all I wanted to tell you about gets. So there's a lot more what you can do here with given. So if you look at this, you have like, oh, sorry. You have stuff like you can specify header, you can specify content type, you can specify cookies. So this all works in the same way. You can specify authorization, which I'm going to show. And that's what I'm going to show now, I think. Yeah, so I also have a secure endpoint, which is basically the same as this endpoint, but it's behind basic authentication. So you can see here, you know, I need a username and a password. Right, so if I'm going to access that, oh, sorry, why doesn't it? Oh, right. So if I'm going to change this to the secure URL, and just run the test again, it will fail miserably because of basic authentication. 401, yeah? So now I can add authentication to the given. So it's really easy, and rest assured you can change authorization here. And you say I want to have basic authentication. You can also use certificate authentication, digest, and form, and even OAuth is supported, so that's really cool. So basic, well, I know the username and the password, like this. And now it will pass the test, I hope. So now you have now you are accessing a server behind authentication, a service behind authentication. You can also time stuff. So if you want to know, you know, this takes way, this might take too long, I can say something like time, and then I say like now I need a matcher. So it's a Hemquest matcher. So I don't want this call to take less than like, well, let's say 1 millisecond, yeah? Because we want to see it fill. So it's less than one. And then I think I need a time unit, so I set it to milliseconds. And if I run this, it will fill because it says here, expected response time was not a value less than 1 millisecond, and was actually 700 milliseconds. So of course, when I set this to like 1,000, it should work fine again. That's great. So that is a little bit about timing. This is the only support for like timing unit tests that Rest Assured has. So if you really want to do performance testing, I would do something like this. So you have a framework, it's called ContiPerf. And in that case, you can say, you know, I can really specify what performance requirements I have. So I would like to do 10 invocations here, and 95% should be below 1,000 milliseconds. So if you have really crude timing tests, you can use Rest Assured. But I would really use ContiPerf to really solve this. So authentication we've seen, it takes longer than 1 second. Oh yeah. What you can also do is, you've seen me do this quite a lot, right? Status code is 200. So if you repeat this a lot, you can actually write a spec builder to reuse this kind of stuff. So what I'm going to do is, make a response specification. And then I can say, you know, I always expect status code 200 here. And now I can replace this with a spec. This is the deprecated method, I think. So I'm going to use this. And it was called assert OK. It's a builder, so I have to build it. And now this will have the same outcome, I hope. Yeah, it does. So this allows you to really reuse, common requests setup. So there's also a request spec builder that you can use. But if you see what's on this, so you can do all kinds of stuff, right? Oh, sorry, this is not the one. Expect status code, root pass, expect body, so you can test for cookies, you can test for headers, there's all kinds of stuff in here. So the same goes for a request spec builder, which I'm not going to show right now because of timing reasons. So now we've done a lot of get stuff, and now I'm going to post some stuff, so that's also interesting. So when I post stuff, of course, I need some entity, right, to post. So I want to post a new conference. And you can do it in a couple of ways. You can say, OK, I want to make a JSON object. So this helps me, you don't want to see me type all the time. So this is a little bit more quick. So in the Netherlands, we have a conference called JFOL. It's really cool. So you should check that out. This is a new conference, and I want to post this to the service. So I'm gonna post this, so given, and then body here, because this is setting up the request, and I can just put the conference in there, and then when post, what was it, conference, then status code 200, because it should accept this request. I can run this, and lo and behold, it doesn't get accepted. And why is that? Because a post request in a Spring Boot application requires a content type if you don't specify anything. So I have to specify a content type on this. What I told you before was that I can, well, come on. Yes. In a given, I can specify all kinds of stuff for my request. So now I can do like a header, and it's like content type application JSON. So that should be enough. And now it runs. And content type is a pretty common header. So I could also have done like this. So content type application JSON, and it's a little bit shorter. Yeah, so that's the same. Same goes for like accept headers. You can specify those directly also. So those are all syntactic sure. It's a little bit of a shortcut. So now I have a post ready, and what I can do is I could have also written it through a domain object. So now I've created a JSON object. But for example, when you're testing your own service, you probably have the domain object on your class path as well. So you can do something like just make a normal conference object. And Rest Assured will, if, for example, JaxB is on the class path or Jackson is on the class path, it will automatically marshal it to a JSON request. So you don't have to specify anything in order for this to work. So you see it still works. And then, of course, you know, if I want like now do some like CRUD operation, so I'm going to insert something, I'm going to check something, I'm going to delete something, so like something transaction-ish, but it's not really transactional because this is a real network call, of course. I can extract stuff from the response. So I can do like extract and then pass. Oh, sorry. Pass. And ID. So this post request actually echoes the object back to me with an ID from the persistence layer. So now I have the idea, and of course then I have to like assign this to like this might be a long, no, this might be an integer. Yep, it is. Oh wait, I don't know yet. Yeah, it is. And now of course I can do a get again and get conference. Let's see which one do we get. Given param ID. And get conference URL. Then, and you've seen this quite before, status code 200. So this should work, and you could also try to like do it like this and do a delete, right? So this should also work. I think that's it, yeah, because I have to get here, I have to delete here. So I'm going to post something, check it, and delete it immediately again. So this still works. So you can also can extract stuff from your response and then do something else with it. So that's really cool. And let's see, that's the normal demo, that's the easy parts of the demo I have given. So I hope I've given you a quick impression of how Rest Assured works. So it's really easy to work with. You can write tests in like seconds. So that's really cool. I'm going to switch back to my presentation for a moment. Where is it? Yeah. No, that's not one. That's not the one. Let's see. Extend. That's not the one either. No, wait. I'm just going to mirror this and let's see. So. Yeah, that's right. So I was on page 12, I think. You've seen this already. So yeah, I'm going to skip this because this was just a backup for if the demo didn't work. So what else can you do with Rest Assured? So you've already seen me use basic authentication, right? So you can also use OAuth1, OAuth2, custom authentication also, but also form authentication. And this is an example. So if you have a Spring Boot application, a Spring Boot application has default parameters for form authentication. So it's called JSpring Security Check is the default, and always the field names are JUsername and JPassword, right? So in this way, you can specify form authentication in Rest Assured. Because you use the defaults here, you can also shorten it like this. So form auth config Spring Security. This is the same as this. Someone you want to take a picture, yeah. You can also specify cookies, again in the given, so nothing special. It's really easy to understand. And you can also use JSON schema validation if you want. So this is, you can actually specify your schema in JSON, and you can use this to test if your service holds up to the schema. Now I would only use this for testing your own service, because if you test someone else's service, for example through contract testing or something like this, you have a little bit of tight coupling, because you only want to get from this response what you need, right? So don't do this in like testing a server from somebody, a service from somebody else. You can also do multipart, so give a multipart file and then you can upload a class, you can upload a file and then see if this file has been received. And there's also session support. So rest assured supports something like filters, and it's basically kind of an around advice around your request and response. So in this case, you can say, okay, I have a session filter and the session cookie I want to keep for the requests after this. So this allows you to go through a session with state. That's also pretty cool. If you're behind a proxy, you can specify a proxy host with authorization. And this is pretty important because you've seen me testing right now and it goes to a default port, 8080. So standard port of rest assured is 8080. You can change this behavior through given, so you can do given, port, and then something else. Or you can set the constants in rest assured class. So for example, rest assured port and rest assured proxy. You can also specify yourself. Or again, with the request spec builder. So you can also, in the request spec builder, say with port, and it will have the same effect. And there are a bunch of other properties in this rest assured class as well that you can set to tweak your tests. And of course, you can use a system property, for example, to pass this stuff to your unit tests. So this was basic rest assured. Now I want to show you a few quick demos with Spring. So what I'm going to show you is how to tie this with a Spring Boot IT test. So any one of you working with Spring Boot IT tests? Yeah, a few of you, okay. So what this basically does, for those who don't know, is it spins up a Spring Boot application just within a unit test and then goes on to test all kinds of things on it. So in this case, because it is an out-of-process test, you can use rest assured as you normally do, because it will just spin up on a random port somewhere, or a specific port if you force this. And with traditional Spring applications, it's an in-memory process test, so it's in process. In that case, there is a different class. You don't use the rest assured class, but you use the rest assured mock MVC class. And what this does, it doesn't make a network call, but what it actually does, it ties into the dispatcher servlet of your traditional Spring application and make calls to that. But as you will see in the code sample I will give you, the programming model is like 95% the same, with a few exceptions. Mocking dependencies, sometimes you have like, for example, my conference service want to get a bunch of speakers from somewhere. So the way you normally do this is you mock out this service and then you spin up your test framework and proceed to test stuff, right? So, but you have to make sure that you spin up this mock yourself. So I'm going to show that as well. Let's see. Okay, here we go again. Good, now it works in one go. That's really cool. So I'm going to show you a Spring Boot IT test first. What was the name? Yeah. So what does this look like? I will get rid of this for a moment. So for those of you who are not familiar with Spring Boot tests, so basically what you do is you say, I want this Spring Boot application to run on a random port. So that is what the annotation here says, right? Web environment random port. So it spins up a port that is not in use. That is how it works. And then, of course, I start to insert maybe some default conference that I want to test against. So if you want to see what that looks like, it's just a normal SQL script. Let's see if my laser pointer works. Yeah, it does. So it basically is just a normal insert statement, right? So, and I've specified rollback here because I want to make sure that every test data I've inserted into my database is rolled back. I think this is default, by the way, so I could just have omitted this. But for clarity reasons, I have now included it. And then, of course, the normal rest assured test is there, and it's just rest assured as normal, right? So it's a normal network call. So if you run this, it will spin up a new Spring Boot application on an unused port. And now you want this. And it fails miserably. Why? So if you look at what is actually going wrong. Oh, I have to stop this one. Sorry. That's the old one. So I'm going to run this again. And now it takes a while. Why? Because it now says connection refused. Why is that? Can anyone think of it? So it says here random port. I'll give you a subtle hint. So yeah, the problem is that this application is spun up on a random port, and what rest assured does, I told you before, is go to 8080, right? So now how do I get this random port? So Spring Boot actually has some support for this, so I can say local server port, and it will give me the port. So like this. So it will inject it from the Spring Boot container, and now I can use it in my request. Port. So port. Yeah, of course. Yeah, so I'm gonna repeat if anyone knows a good code formatter for this. So let's run it again. And now it's green, right? So now it has detected the correct port, and this is just rest assured as normal. So integrating this in Spring Boot is really easy. So if you look at a traditional Spring application, it's a little bit more complicated because you have to tie in into the dispatcher server because everything runs in one process. So what you have to do is you use not the rest assured class anymore, but you use the rest assured mock MVC class. And it has the same programming model as the normal rest assured class, but for example, if you use authorization, it's a little bit different. So you can look this up in the reference guide. But it looks quite the same, so the test is the same. But now you have to say to rest assured mock MVC, tie into the existing Spring context. So this is the only thing you have to do. And after that, you have to reset it. I'm not quite sure what it does, but the spec says you should do this anyway because it's a nice teardown, so it's symmetrical, you know, before and after. And let's see. So SQL insertion is just the same as a Spring Boot application. Oh yeah, and I have an example here of, you know, what authorization looks like. So if you remember, authorization on Spring Rest Assured class was like authorization basic and then my credentials. So it looks a bit different here because it has to tie in into Spring Security in memory. So that's why the programming model is different. If you go to HTTP Basic, you'll see that it ties into the Spring classes. But the differences are pretty minor. So to prove that this works. And if you look at this, I have another Groovy. It doesn't, okay. For time's sake, I won't figure out right now. But you can see that it says here another Groovy expression. So it does the same as the expression I showed you earlier. But this is a special word. It's IT and it's the iteration. So it's basically the list of conferences you get back. So that's how a traditional Spring application looks like. So I have one more example for you. And I think it's Spring Boot with wire mocking. Yeah. So I have an extra service, and it's called, let's see, where is it? A conference with speakers, and what this does is basically give me the same conference information back, but with speaker information, and it will get the speaker information from somewhere else. But this service, of course, isn't running on my system, so I have to mock it. So I'm using WireMock for this. So what it basically does is it spin up a server on a certain port, and it says here, you know, for any URL that comes in, I will want to send the default response. And I'm building that here. And that's just a simple JSON array that gives back my name. And it's just a list of speakers, right? So this is what the service actually expects. And you could ask, yeah, where does it get the port from? So it gets the port from here, server speaker endpoint, which is included in the same Spring Boot application context. So this will always match if you configure it like this. And the port will be configured, I think, yeah, there at the end, right? This is all on GitHub, so don't worry, you don't have to remember it right now. So this is the last of the demos I've given. So I will wrap this up a little bit. We've seen this. Yeah, so first time I used this, I really had this like experience from this is really cool. I can really use this in my projects. Writing tests takes almost no time, and it's really readable for, well, not really business analysts, but you know, every developer that understands a little bit about BDD can read this, no problem, and the API is also really great. So this was love at first sight for me, really good. Yeah, I already summarized this. So it has a really flexible programming model. I haven't showed you even if you get XML back instead of JSON, you can just use the same assertions. So no need to change to XPath, although you can do that if you want to have really intricate assertions, but you don't need it, and you get relatively fast feedback. So starting up like a REST test takes a while, but if you have like 10 tests in one unit test, it goes really blazingly fast. Contract testing, well, don't use it for this. You could use it, but if you have who has heard of Pact or Spring Cloud Contracts? One, yeah, maybe two. Okay, you should really check that out. That's really cool. So you replay your requirements. You record your requirements for this other service, and this other service will get this stuff and replay them. So if this matches, you know the contract is okay. It's really cool stuff. But don't use REST Assured for that. And yeah, improvements. This third time I'm saying this. If somebody can find a good code formatter for this, IntelliJ has done nothing about this. This will really help because I'm really sick of doing like top shift top that kind of stuff, you know. So thanks very much. The sample project is located there on my private GitHub. If you want to check out the reference, you can go to restassured.io. And if you have any questions after this conference, you can email me at the email address below, right? So, any questions? A question pops into your mind anyway, so after this, feel free to approach me, you know, and ask questions you want. So I want to thank you for this, and see you next time.